Yo, it's Mel from Rap Rankings. To hear the full episode this clip comes from and all the other episodes, stop by raprankings.com or search Rap Rankings on your favorite podcast platform.
And welcome back. We have a guest. I think you know who he is because so far every 80s rap album we've done, he has been the guest. He's a bit of an oracle in that regard, the hip-hop historian himself. He recently contributed fact-checking to the new Hip Hop and Other Things book that's coming out in October by Shea Serrano. The man of many talents. You know him well. Rap Rankings Universe, welcome back, Dart Adams.
What up? Hey. Once again in the building, it's me.
We love it. We absolutely love it. This is always a great experience for me because I mean, it's probably forever going to be one of my biggest blind spots in hip hop history, you know, given I wasn't born until 93 and didn't really become conscious in a hip hop sense, I would say until like 2007. So,
yeah,
you know, it's always nice to just sit and listen and learn something. And this track specifically, when I heard you were coming on for, you know, Moulz and I joke like off air, it's like, because I don't think we had listened to the album yet. It's like, oh man, I hope we like it. Because like, we never want to be in a position where like we invite you on and it's like, oh, what's these like two young guys who don't know anything about this? Like, but luckily not. I mean, you can go ahead and spoil it. I think we'll probably all like this record.
Yeah.
So.
I mean, it's never really a problem because the thing that I think a lot of older heads don't understand is that the music and the feeling and the whole context of it when we heard it, like, you can't replicate that. So I don't particularly get insulted when somebody doesn't quite understand it or get it. But I can walk them through why it's important and its significance, and I don't necessarily need them to like revere it. But I always appreciate when people go back and at least try to like figure it out. Just like this, like people get mad, man. This, we're not born knowing everything, you know. I had to go back and watch a whole bunch of black and white films and read old books and stuff like that in order to understand the history of everything. So it is what it is, man. I think people get too butthurt.
To be honest, I think that curiosity in people in general is rare. So, you know, just being able to go back and, you know, take in all of this history, some people are just totally averse to the practice entirely. So,
yeah.
I think it's less about liking everything or feeling the same way about it as the people who experienced it in real time, but more so just educating yourself about it and really understanding how foundational a lot of this stuff is to the stuff Absolutely. That you probably do like.
Absolutely.
All right. So before we get too deep into it, of course, you know, on Rap Rankings and everything, we have a whole rating system. But with Dart being a returning guest, I think for the third time now, we usually don't go through the explanation of that again for returning guests. We figure they know what the deal is. But if we have any new listeners, or Dart, if you want us to go through it again just for familiarity's sake,
go through it again for the neophytes.
Okay. So here's the rating system. It's simple. Each song is rated on a scale of 1 to 10. These numbers do not reflect the quality of a song, as that is indeterminable. Instead, each number reflects a level of enjoyment. In short, here's what each number means. 10 means it's a perfect song to me, one of my favorite songs of all time. 9 means I love it. 8 means I like it a lot. 7 means I like it. 6 means it's all right. I don't dislike it, but I can't say that I like it. 5 means I feel practically nothing about this. 4 means it's not the worst thing I've ever heard, but I dislike it. 3 just means I dislike it. 2 means I hate it. And 1 means I absolutely can't stand it. One of the worst things I've ever heard. Side note, you could add a plus or a minus to those numbers. They don't have any mathematical or statistical value. They're just indicators that mean one of two things. 1, it's like saying a strong or light version of that number, like a 6 plus would be like a strong 6, or a 7 minus would be like a light 7. Or it's an indicator it can go up or down in the future because the ratings aren't static on the show. You know, we change our minds sometimes when presented with new information, things like that.
Which is the way everything should be.
Yeah. Yeah. I think so. You know, never be afraid to change your mind about things. But yeah, that's pretty much it. if you have a rating in mind, with that said, you can go first or we can lead off, however you want to do
it. Yeah, fine. I'll lead off. Poison's a 10, and I'll explain why.
Wow, nice.
So this album was released in early 1989. So we're talking between February and March 1989. The lead single is called Road to the Riches, and the B-side was Butcher Shop. I had it on Kasingle. My brother and I had it. Now, I need to explain to you something about this album. This is the last song on the album. Am I correct?
No, there's one more song after this one, Butcher Shop, I believe.
Okay, so this is the second to last song on the album. On some versions,
yeah, Butcher Shop was just a CD exclusive.
Yes,
I believe.
So this is the thing. Butcher Shop was the B-side to Road to the Riches, right? And on the cassette version, because I'm an old, this was the last song on the album. On the CD version, which in 1989 a CD was considered, what's the term I'm looking for? A luxury purchase. It was the bonus track, which we found out later because who bought the CD? We all bought cassettes. But the reason why this song is a 10 is because I'm going to walk you through this. 1986, the first song from Kool G Rap and DJ Polo is released. It's called It's a Demo / I'm Fly, being the B-side. It's a Demo was released in 1986. It's a Demo is on this album. The next single is called, it was remade Iraq Island. It's called Rikers Island. I don't think it actually made the album for whatever reason. So that's just crazy. That single was released in 1987. Poison, which was the A and B side, released on Prism, was released in 1988. I repeat, this was released in 1988. 1988 is pretty much the year where everything happened. Summer of 88 might as well have been the big bang in terms of rap, but we all know it wasn't. But summer of 88 was so super competitive. It felt like every classic album, every week was another classic album, right? And here you have Poison being released. Now, the reason why Poison is so iconic and so insane is because it's released in 1988 as pretty much every classic single it seemed that dropped out of the sky. Now, Poison stood out from the rest of the pack in a pack full of classic, classic, classic material. And here's the thing about Poison that people don't fully grasp. That's where they're. The single comes out. The song Poison is 6 minutes damn near, okay? Now, here's what's insane about Poison. There's a radio version. The radio version of Poison clocks in at 2 minutes and 30 seconds.
Wow.
So the reason why Poison is almost 6 minutes long is because it's lead up, Kool G Rap Polo, you know, Poison and scratches and just beats. And then Kool G Rap raps his ass off. And then there's a break in the middle. Then Kool G Rap raps his ass off some more. Then there's a break. And then Kool G Rap raps his ass off some more. And then there's a break. And then he gives shout outs. Now, I'm going to explain something to you about the radio version. I'm using the air quotes. You can't see me. The radio version of Poison. They only use the first two verses. They take out all the scratching and all the extras. They use a different beat. So you get the first two verses, and then when the second verse ends, you hear Polo going, "Yeah, Poison," and then they fade it out. Now, here's the thing. Here's the thing about why Poison is such an iconic song. The first verse, insane, Super Saiyan 3. Second verse, insane, Super Saiyan 4. However, when they come back from the break and all the scratching, yada, 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 you get the third verse. The third verse is Future Trunks, Godbreaker level. The third verse is the verse that converted everybody who were non-believers into converts of the church of Kool G Rap is the illest motherfucker alive. The third verse, homonyms, synonyms, good like M&Ms. My brain glow like a rainbow. This man says some off the wall shit like Peter Parker. The third verse of Poison should be hanging in the Louvre. Someone should just write the verses down and just hang that in the Louvre. We don't. It's not even a painting. Like, oh, Kool G rap lyrics. Yeah, this is ill. And the crazy thing about Poison, right, is that this was the gut punch in 88 to let you know. I don't know when this album's coming out, but I'm going to be the first person in line to buy it. And the thing is that it's not like this single was a huge hit. It's not like this single was blew up. It's not like this single was like in everybody's Walkman or in everybody's collection. No, it was only in the Heads collections. And you knew you were with somebody official if they could recite Poison word for word. And when this song came on, people danced hard. I'm talking about they danced hard. When I say hard, I'm not talking H-A-R-D. I'm talking H-O-A-R-D. I'm talking about, do you remember?
Okay.
Yeah, do you remember the episode of Fresh Prince of Bel-Air when Carlton was on those drugs, that speed? And he was
dancing? Oh, yeah. Classic episode.
Yeah. In the immortal words of my boy Danny Brown, the drugs that had Carlton dancing fast. Yeah. That's how you would be dancing. That's how cats would be dancing when Poison came on. Poison. So, and that's also why, like, when Bell Biv DeVoe made the single Poison, like, it was Spider-Man and Freeze in full effect. We're like, well, obviously, we're going to pull up, like, one of the illest all-time songs, Poison. Poison,
so,
and you said.
Mel, you got the archival audio for this, right?
Yeah, I do. I got it loaded up. I'll hit it right now.
Kool G Rap and Polo. Back again. What? This is Poison. Poison.
Yeah, Spider-Man and Freeze in full effect.
Uh-huh. You ready, Ron?
I'm ready.
You ready, Poison. Dave?
I'm ready, Slick. Are you?
Now you need to think about something. Poison was one of the biggest hits in the world. The single Poison, not so much, but it was a staple amongst the Heads, and it was a signal to everybody on the dance floor. And that's why this is crucial. When you heard bang, Kool G Rap Polo, bang, back again. That was, and then bang, that break, bang. It was giving you enough time to get your crew, assemble your crew, and rush to the fucking dance floor and get in formation and start doing your routine. Because there were routines to this song, right?
Wow.
And it's a staple. It is a staple. It's official in the annals of hip hop lore. But was it a hit? No. But the single Poison was a hit. Now, also, to show you how much this song is burnt into the memory of Heads. When you listen to songs like Boom, a line from it is actually used by my man Black Thought, who also is a disciple of Kool G Rap and Big Daddy Kane simultaneously.
Yep. Now we heard on Boom, he did Rakim, Big Daddy Kane, and Kool G Rap. We talked about it a little bit on your last appearance.
Who are the big three?
Right. And that's why we've tackled them first on this show with you. And we have a little bit of audio from Boom of Black Thought doing this third verse from Poison.
Yeah, let me hit that now.
A little bit of a twist on it.
I'm not designed to find a rhyme that's right on time. One step beyond and not behind a line. To separate thought from divine, you could take it as a caution. Over warning sign, look for antonyms, words I'm sending them. Pononyms, synonyms, good like Eminem. You know the time when it's Reed G slicing. I turn the mic's last name into Tyson. My brain like a factory, constantly creating material stitch by stitch. The decoration, the lyrics are fabric. The beat is a rhyming. My passion of rhyming is fashion designing. Now it gets sorted. These people want to support it, support it. If you didn't, then you couldn't.
Now, I want y'all to wrap your brains around this. There were people that heard Boom that hadn't heard Poison in 1988 or in 1989 when the album came out. Because again, this album did not go gold, didn't come close to really going gold, but you know, the Heads had it. A famous statement by the much maligned Russell Simmons is when Nas's material was brought to him, his response after hearing Nas's material, which is probably one of the all-time greatest demos in the history of demos, this son bitch said, and I repeat, he sounds too much like Kool G Rap, and Kool G Rap doesn't sell records. Fuck you, Russell Simmons. also, he's right. Kool G Rap didn't sell records. But, Kool G Rap is top five dead or alive, and that's just off a gang of LPs when it comes to MCing, and he is a staple. He is a cornerstone in the art of MCing. And also, I need to point out that Poison coming out in 1988 when it did, how much rap changed from when that single dropped to between like February and March, like mid-March around the time this album comes out. And also, I need to just hammer this home, guys. When this album dropped, the rap charts were brand new on Billboard. Brand spanking new. Like, they still had the new baby smell, right? So this single, this album drops, and this and they have the single, you know, Road to the Riches and Butcher Shop on the B-side climbing up the charts, right? When the album drops, and people are still referencing in their head Poison. And again, do you know how strong a single had to be in the days when rap was just coming into the LP era for the B-side to be the same as the A-side? In 1988 of all years, you're going to be like, yeah, it's one song. A-side, B-side, same shit. Yeah, and what? Wait, hold on a second. You ain't going to put another song on the B-side? No. Are you? Yes. Oh, it's Kool G Rap, ain't it? Yeah. All right. Yeah, you could do that.
I've never even heard of the A side and the B side being the same song. Like, that's.
It's a rare occurrence, but it happened. And the song had better been fire. And again, like I mentioned, nothing was weirder than the fact that you had the first, both versions on the A side, I believe, were almost 6 minutes long. And then I think the B-side is the radio mix, which is an affront to MCing, lyricism, and hip-hop. How dare you remove the third verse? That's like, oh my God. It's like cloning, like Jennifer Lopez and like not having an ass. It's like, what are you doing? What are you doing? It's like just a long back. Why did you even clone her for? That's the star of the show. Do you have to ask somewhere else? Is it in the drawer? What the fuck? Yeah, man. So basically, Poison, man. Poison is a 10. And it's insane because it ends the album. At least the cassette tape. Butcher Shop is the CD. But I didn't see the CD for like a year afterwards. Oh, there's a bonus track? And again, the album didn't sell like that for us to even know.
For historical purposes, I gotta know, did the CD and the tape drop the same day?
Well, he said it didn't come out for like a while. So,
He said he didn't hear it for a while.
Yes. I believe. Oh, okay. Yeah. It's like the CD and the tape dropped the same day. But again, in 1989, a CD was a luxury purchase. Like, to give you an example, my brother and I used to go out and used to buy cassette tapes. Myself, my younger brother, and like my older brother, 6 years older than me. My older brother had a job, right? My older sister, you know, she was 8 years older than me. I've mentioned this before. And she had a really good job because she graduated from Wellesley College. And, she was gainfully employed. So she had an excellent starting salary. So my sister was doing well in the late 80s, early 90s. So my sister was like, I'm not going to buy a cassette. I'm buying a CD because a crackhead got us a CD, a 5-CD changer, because that's the only way you're going to have that type of shit in the hood. She wanted to be like, well, I'm going to enjoy this thing. So I'm buying CDs. This is the long box era. Now, to keep in mind, a cassette tape back then would cost you anywhere between $6.99, $7.99 if you buy it on sale at Tower Records. So we're talking $7.34 and $8.39. Okay? $7.34, $8.39 cash. We're talking 1989 cash. Do a conversion. Go to the conversion chart, the inflation calculator, the U.S. inflation calculator. Go find that to find out how much $8 in 1989 was versus 2021. Your mind will be blown. But my sister was buying CDs, and CDs were like $16.99. She was spending like $17.84, and sometimes it would be on sale maybe for like $14.99. So we're talking
1989 money.
Yeah. So we're talking like $15-$16 for a CD, and that's almost twice as much as I spent on a cassette tape. And I'm like, God damn. So
I just did the calculation on the inflation for the cassette, like $8. That would be $17.37 today.
Yeah. So, and what would $17 be?
Right. So for the CD today, that would be $36.91.
Yeah. To give you an idea, that's if you go to old Tower, I mean, not Tower Records, if you go to old Billboard magazines, and actually have a United States Postal Service crate full of old billboards in front of me that I use for research, you would look up CDs, and in the late 80s, they would be under luxury purchases.
Wow.
And there were CD selling charts to give you an idea how different it was to buy a CD than to purchase a cassette tape or just vinyl. Right? So, yeah, man, Poison is one of the all-time greats, one of the staples, and it is like the anchor song on a classic album, which a lot of people didn't buy. But in retrospect, when we go back and we're like, yo, whose catalogs do we need to listen to or whose albums do we need to study? The name always comes up, Kool G Rap and Polo, yep. Their first album, their debut album, Road to the Riches, is a classic. You need to hear it. And the thing is that a lot of people don't want to admit it, but not everybody heard this album. And the other thing is that if you did hear it, you probably didn't buy it. Someone else had it, or someone bootlegged it, or you heard somebody's copy, or you had a friend who had it, and you were always at their house listening to it on their dime, and you didn't put in the money to buy it yourself. But
to your point, this was the last of the three that not only we're getting to on the show, but myself. You know, I came to discover Big Daddy Kane and Eric B. and Rakim when I was in high school. I didn't get to this album probably till my freshman year in college.
Yeah. I mean, it's crazy because I believe that their profile was raised with each album. So their second album, Wanted Dead or Alive, I believe they had more of a higher profile with releasing Streets of New York, you know. Maybe a race racism because the video got played a significant amount on Yo MTV Raps. But that third album, was it Live and Let Die? With Sir Jinx and oh my God, that night, that album forever will signify winter for me. My brother and I would get on the train, get on the Orange Line in Boston to go to school, or the Green Line, which was Jesus Christ. And we'd be playing this cassette tape. And back in the days, you had a Walkman, you had your headphones, the Nova 45s from Radio Shack. And everybody on the train would be hearing what's playing in your headphones. And and old white ladies would be shook sitting next to you listening to some Kool G Rap shit like Number One with a Bullet. Just hearing some of the most vile, gangster, dirty, filthy lyricism ever, but it's done so well and so impeccably.
Right. And that's how, you know, he starts getting more into the mafioso raps.
Yeah.
But as we covered earlier, and you know, I'm a big fan of 4-5-6.
Oh, good.
I think that out of Rakim, Big Daddy Kane, and Kool G Rap sort of eased into the 90s most comfortably.
Well, also 4-5-6 surprisingly ended up the number one album on the R&B charts. That was like redemption, I felt, to me, because I remember 4, 5, 6 was an interesting album because I was at Morgan State after it came out in Baltimore in 1996, January 96. And I remember sitting in my dorm room and I would hear cars driving by playing that album. Or sometimes you just like go to basketball practice, shit ain't never gonna change. Fuck it. So we take them to war. I'm like, y'all got this album too? And I was like, yo, did everybody buy this album the day it came out? And then people stopped buying it? Like, but that album, I felt like it was everywhere. It was everywhere. It's a shame. Hey, doom-doom-doom-doom. Like, and then I think Fast Life was the thing, though. Because Jesus Christ, when the Fast Life video came out, man, mm-mm. Kool G Rap and Nas, the guy who Russell Simmons said he sounded like, and he wouldn't sign him because he wouldn't sell. And then Search goes across to Columbia and he's like, hey, Faith, I know you left Def Jam for a reason, right? You know that kid you've been looking for? Well, listen to this, you know? Yeah.
You know, on the topic of just like transitioning to the 90s, and of course, like in relation to the other three rappers that we've covered so far, like Rakim and Big Daddy Kane, I wanted to ask you, Dar, because I found it interesting. Like when I turned this album on, like track one, like the very first track, the title track, you know, he basically is rapping and mentions like selling drugs. And I was like, this is like the first time I can recall hearing a rapper of this era take like that position on record. Like,
really?
Yeah, like I noticed, because usually like Big Daddy Kane and Rakim was usually rapping just about like the art of MCing, and you know, occasionally like some, you know, you throw in some commentary and things like that. But I'm like, huh, this is like the first, at least on this show so far, where it's like, huh, like, oh, he's rapping about like actually living like that life in the streets.
I mean, the first time I heard something like that was probably like between 85 and 86. But the thing is that when he did it, like, he wanted to do it in a way that was reflective of what was happening in the streets, but keep it MC. When there were cats that did it, they were like, all right, we're going to talk about some drug gangster shit, but it's about the drug gangster shit. Know what I'm saying?
Right.
When he did
so
it,
like proto gangster rap, whereas he was more, MC centric.
Yeah. But right, he was more MC centric. However, then it got into a thing where storytelling and crafting a story and composing a narrative, right? So like when people talk about the greatest all time storytellers in rap, you know, people like to jump to, people first like to start with, you know, Slick Rick, of course. And then nowadays some people jump to Kool G Rap. And I'm like, you just jumped over, to Ghostface Killah. And I'm like, you jumped over Kool G Rap. Like, Kool G Rap is some of the most compelling cinematic story raps. Like, when you listen to Biggie and you listen to, like, some of Nas's story raps and other people that came after them, you know that they listened to Kool G Rap. Kool G Rap was so good with it that he didn't like to, you know, pull it out all the time. But sometimes he would just overdo it, like, just to show everybody up. Like, The Boss's Wife, a gangster love story, I think, in three parts that he did on his album, Roots of Evil. Who heard Roots of Evil? The Roots of Evil album he did in 1998. Not the greatest production, but that man was carrying that album like
on a storytelling level.
Yeah, like KD carried the Nets, you know?
Yeah.
When Harden was hobbled. Like, he is so great at rapping that it makes me sick to say. Like I'm my face is scrunched up and I'm kind of disgusted at myself talking about this goddamn song that is like a masterpiece. Because here's the thing, before I jumped on here, I decided to just listen to it again, not that I haven't heard it 4 million times. And as I'm listening to it, I'm listening to the first verse, I'm like, Jesus Christ. I listen to the second verse, I'm like, wow. And I know the third verse is coming. I know it's coming, but when the third verse starts, he's already like, all right, let me just take off this inhibitor belt. You know what I'm saying? Let me stop playing with y'all. It was kind of like when homie and Naruto took off the weights.
Yeah, I think Rock Lee.
Yeah, Rock Lee. When Rock Lee took off the weights, it's huge on YouTube now because it became like a meme thing through Twitter and YouTube. But I think of that as like that's kind of thing where it's just like, wait a minute. He's been fighting the whole time with just a few weights, and then the weights hit the ground. And you're like, wait, that's hundreds of pounds. Yeah. It's like, yeah, now I can move really fast. You know what I'm saying? It's like, what the?
Yeah, there were definitely moments on here where, like, you know, I wish I could remember the flow, but, like, I wrote in my notes, like, this flow is going crazy. Like, it's like, the part, like, I really, like, started to sit up in bed. He's like, biters are warning, like, animals hunt it. As soon as I get him, I hit him, I done it. The suckers who fronted, the rappers who made it and did it, forget about winning. And I'm just like, all right. You know, this still holds up.
And think about, like, Minute Work, right? Minute Work, like, there's a song called Thought at Work by Black Thought of the Roots.
Yep,
and
we played a little bit
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And then, like, and it's, like, an homage to that era of Kool G Rap, right? But then you think about, you got songs like Trilogy of Terror, and then like he has to dial it back, you know, he has to like dial it back, you know, so it's like Truly Yours, which is another song that was, you know, remade by Pete Rock, you know, when he's not telling people that COVID is a conspiracy.
Oh my God, he's on one these days.
Yeah, but again, it cracks me up that this album, it opens with Road to the Riches, which is this recent single, and then it goes to, it's a demo, which is from 1986, and it's on an album from 1989, and you're not like, what? Because think about how much rap changed from 1986 to 1989. There were MCs that were making singles and hits in 86 and getting recognition in 86 that by March 1989, they couldn't get arrested. And I mean, if there's anything you should have been doing, been able, easy for you to do in 89 during the crack era is get arrested. But like, but straight up, like rap had changed so much. And it was like, they heard us a demo and was like, this guy was 5 years ahead of his time. So we'll just put it on the album 3 years later. No problem. That's nuts to me.
That is nuts to think about. Cause like, I mean, most times these days you might get an artist who recorded something maybe like a year and a half old and put it on the album. But like to be 3 whole years old and not have any noticeable drop off in like ability.
And you notice,
like, I'm that's that's impressive.
You notice I'm flying on album, right? Like I'm flying on album. Which was the B side. And Rikers Island from 87, like it's not on the album, but it's so memorable that, again, Nori did his own version, Iraq Island, the 40 Island, on his debut album, right? And it's funny because when they redid that song, me being an old, I remember cats who bought the album for Nori, who, you know, loved the Neptunes and everything else, and, like, kind of got into the War Report late for these kids, and they had no idea that Rikers Island was even a song. They didn't even know what the song was referencing or why Kool G Rap was on it. And that just blew my mind listening to that.
Well, like, I'm gonna tell you right now, I know the Capone and Noriega album you're referring to, and I know the song you're referring to. I've never heard the Kool G Rap Rikers Island song, the original. So to this day, to this very moment in time, I haven't heard it. So I gotta go listen myself. This is why I love having you on here.
This is, we were just having a conversation, like, Moulz and I, about, like, you know, generation gaps and things, like, a couple weeks ago. Like, I was at my cousin's wedding, and the DJ was there, and he started playing Doo-Wop, That Thing by Lauryn Hill, which I know, like, word for word. And I started rapping it, and, like, my younger brother and my cousin, who were, I think, both born in 99, were looking at me like I was crazy. And in my mind, you know, I was... When that song came out, you know, I grew up with that album. I was born in 93. So, like, I remember it being on the radio. I know it word for word. So, to me, in my brain, in my context, it's a classic that, like, everyone knows. And then as I look at them in their eyes, I realize they don't know it. And they're looking at me crazy. Like, what are you doing right now? I'm like, you don't know this song? And like, that's when I realized, like, now at 28, it's like, oh, I'm getting older. Like,
right.
The fact that they don't know this is like wild to me, but it makes sense.
I was telling you that when we had that discussion, that song came out in 97, doo-wop.
I believe that's right. I think it was Miseducation 97 or 98.
98. Okay, so I would have been 11 years old when that song came out, which means that, you know, 9 years earlier, this album we're talking about came out. So you got to realize 9 years ago, right now in 2021, like Drake Take Care came out, or, you know, Big Crit Live from the Underground. Like, those albums are about as old as the Kool G Rap album was to me in 1998.
Right. You know, so it's like, there's going to come a day. And like, I told them, it's like, okay, well, like this music you're listening to now, like, there will be a day when it's like, oh, no one, you're going to be rapping. Yeah, Pooh Shiesty or Polo G or Playboy Cardi, and kids are going to look at you like, what is that? And
you're going to be shocked. I don't know what a Polo G is. Is it a sweater?
I mean, we just found out ourselves like a week or two ago. So, yeah.
Pooh Shiesty sounds like an NBA player from the 1980s.
Yeah! It does. Look, Dart might just need a separate segment. We just got to give him names of the new rappers and just get him to riff on them a little bit.
I remember I was going back and forth with Crooked Eye, or King Crooked as he's now known, and he was talking about, so how do you rap connoisseurs feel about this album? And I was like, well, being a rap connoisseur, I'll never hear it. So that's pretty much where, like, I'm at with it. But again, it's not, I'm not gonna actively go out and just shit on everybody young whose albums I don't listen to, because it's like emojis with me. I don't know the emojis names because I don't use them, so I don't think about them, so I don't have time to berate them. I'm too busy doing things I actually like. You know,
which is the approach I think everyone should have. Like, these new guys, like, they just dropped the XXL freshman list, and I think for the first time ever, I knew like around half or like less than half of the people on there. And you know, my thought wasn't, let me run to Twitter and be like, who are these guys? Like, they must be known by someone. You know, I don't know them. I'm not particularly interested in going out and finding out who they are.
I mean, it is interesting that I realized that, like, people like, Dart, you need to stop doing X, Y, and Z. This is like 8-10 years ago. And now here I am at a space in my life where, like, things are going well. And I just don't feel the need to go in on the XXL freshman list because I have too many good things going on. And I thought that the people that were saying these things were like, you know, just you, what do you want? The people that did that were just, you know, just saying something. It was just like a cliche. No, it's not a cliche. When you have shit going on and you're doing well and you have blessing upon blessings, the blessings come in, right? And you're filling out invoices and you just get paid all the time, right? You don't have time to worry about and berate and diss and go in on certain things because you're doing too well to be salty. Like, it's some real shit. I didn't know.
Yep. My advice to those that are not doing well, get busy. Get busy, and then you'll start doing pretty well.
Dude, like,
you'll be way too busy to worry about this shit.
I haven't gone in really that, like, I'll occasionally go in on, like, trolls on Twitter, but for now, I'll just be blocking them and just, like, they say something, I don't even go back to them. I'm just like, you have 149 followers, so I'm going to give you what you want. I'll just block you. And now you're speaking to the ether, right? And that came when things started going well for me, you know? When like, someone said, hey, we'd like to give you money to do this. Or, hey, we'd like to fly you out to do this. Or, hey, we want you to come over and do speaking gigs. Can you contribute to this? Like, when that shit started happening, I was just like, I suddenly don't feel the need to engage with trolls anymore. You know, it's weird. But also, like, just focus on what you like and what you enjoy. And maybe if someone doesn't quite understand something, maybe try to bridge the gap and try to bring in some, like, understanding, as opposed to, like, just go in and be angry. Ah, you know, both barrels blazing, because there's enough of that in the world. And being in quarantine for almost 16 months, it made me really appreciate things differently. And now I care about things like rugs and furniture.
Sure, yep, when your home becomes, you're pretty much you're locked in.
You start
taking a look at your surroundings, and you're going, "All right."
I never bought more Mr. Clean and Pine Sol until 2020. Like, I look at my wall and I'm like, I can clean that. I need to get new furniture. I can build a new dresser drawer. I didn't do that shit before. I became
motivation that people need to hear.
I became a man of the woods during quarantine, man. I rearranged my whole apartment. I was throwing shit out. I was cleaning stuff. I started washing walls. I was editing books and writing books at the same time, man. When y'all see the shit that comes out in 2022 and I tell you the backstory of how I did all that, y'all gonna be amazed. Shit, I'm gonna be amazed and I was there.
we know, as far as the show, like, last year, like, we just buried ourselves in this. And, you know, it's why I don't really think, like, of course, obviously, with, you know, respect paid to everybody who had a hard time during this entire ordeal. It's like the best way we dealt with it was just pouring everything into this show, you know. And so
I think that comes with a lot of listening, research, more listening, more research.
Yeah.
And, you know, kind of just staying focused on the roadmap. We got all these albums and mixtapes we have to cover. There's a list that will probably die before we get to finish. Thousands of albums. And, you know, Dart is someone who's always, he's always telling people, stop putting up these lists on this 240 character website or whatever it is, where you can't really make any sort of significant statement with 10, 15 names.
You can't.
Right. You know, on that note, man, like, I'm glad you said that, because I was just talking to you about this. And to tie it into what Dart was just saying about, like, you know, basically finding the link and the thread between things and passing generations. It's my brother who's, what is he? I think 21. I'm 28. He came in my room the other day and he showed me, like, this Twitter post. And he was like, this guy was saying Drake is not a top 50 MC of all time. And he came to me because he knew I was a Drake fan and he knows that I know a lot more about hip hop than him. And I was explaining to him, because my brother was like, I don't understand. Like, because to him, Drake would easily be that. And he's like, is he bad? Is he a bad rapper? And I was like, well, here's the thing. I can tell you, as a Drake fan, Drake is not a top 50 MC of all time. Now, the tweet said rapper. And I was like, okay, so you got to understand, like, what the art of MCing and, like, what rapper means, like, in general. If we're talking stature and success and, like, impact, yeah, probably Drake would be considered a top 50 rapper.
Right.
Of all
if
time.
We're just basing things off of accolades and statistics.
Right. But MC, and I was telling my brother, there are hundreds of MCs ahead of Drake.
Yeah.
You know, and we were walking through like the person who tweeted,
I sent you 50 of them.
You sent me 50.
Yeah, but you sent me 50. But here's the thing to think about, right? Like, if you were like, Madonna isn't a top 50 singer, like, you mean a top 50 singer vocalist? No, she's not a top 50 singer vocalist. But if you say Madonna is one of the top 50 artists of all time, and if I saw a list of top 50 greatest artists of all time and I didn't see Madonna on it, I'd be like, this list is some bullshit. How can you leave Madonna off? But if you're like top 50 singers vocalists of all time, like, I don't want to see Madonna on that list. You know what I'm saying?
Well, right.
Like, you know? Like, I better see Madonna, Janet Jackson, you know, some other people, maybe Paula Abdul, some other people on that list. But they're not going to be on the same list as, like, a Mariah Carey or a Janet Jackson or an Aretha Franklin or a Gladys Knight or, you know, some of these old Ruth Brown. All right. Now, I realized when I said Ruth Brown that I was already entering the old head sphere. So I'm going to dial it back. Because a lot of people are going to have to Google who Ruth Brown is. I'm just going to say that the reason why they called it R&B is because Ruth Brown. And she's also a relative of Rakim. So let's just stop there.
Yeah.
Well, before we get too far ahead of ourselves here.
Too late!
Mel, do you have a rating for the song? Do you have an actual rating?
Oh, me?
Yes.
Oh, yeah, I do. Yeah, that's right. I haven't even given a rating. Yeah, so I gave it a 7-. And the minus is only because, and I'll admit, like, during this album, because I grew up, you know, most of the new millennium, I'm, like, a little prissy about, I guess, like, sound quality. So if there's anything, like, I guess, holding this album, not really holding it back, but, like, I had to, like, when I was in the car, I turned all the way up. Like, I even contemplated going into, like, you know, the settings of the music app and, like, messing with the EQ, trying to get it as high as I could. Because, you know, obviously, you know, it's the late 80s. They aren't mastering to like a crazy volume yet, you know, which could be a detriment in itself. But yeah, I mean, like if this was like, this is an album and I'm not even huge on like remastering. I feel like this is an album that could perhaps use remastering. And, you know, as a song itself, it's a easy 7 for me. I like it. This was my first time ever hearing it. So imagine my surprise when it comes in and I hear that Poison. And I'm like, oh my God, this is the BBD sample. Like this is, you know, so that was a delight to hear because I never knew where that came from. And, you know, that's the song that just like won't die. Like Poison is a song that's almost impossible to be nostalgic about because my whole life it's been played. Like it's like the go-to nostalgic song to where it can't even be nostalgic. But I'd never known that that's where that vocal sample came from. So that was great. And I'm just hearing him just like flow out of his mind. And I'm like, you know, there's obviously so much value still in music from this era. So I'm glad to be able to do things like this and make these connections, you know, between eras. So, yeah, it's a 7 for me. I like it. Moulz, what was your rating on it?
I haven't given it out yet, but it was 8-. Ding me, baby. Okay. 8-, because first of all, it influenced Boom, which we played a little bit of, which I absolutely love. You know, that song is honestly responsible. Like, you know, Dart, how you were saying that, like, back in the day, people would try to spit Poison word for word. Mm-hmm. Web and Boom were that for me. So, you know, that song in general, like I wasn't wild about the Tipping Point album. I thought it was good, but not their best. However, those two songs are like in their top 10 greatest songs to me because of what Black Thought did on them. Like that opened up my mind back in 2004 when the album was released to going this far back and really studying these guys. So
The beauty of this album and the beauty of this song is this inspired guys like, again, you know, Black Thought, but it also inspired guys like Big Pun packing a Mac in the back of the act. You know, yep. It also inspired, people don't talk about this nearly enough, guys like Eminem. So the reason why like it inspired guys like Elzai, Royce the 5'9", like anybody who's just stupid with words.
Keep in mind, we're just naming the best rappers alive, basically.
Yeah, there's this guy, I don't know if you ever heard of him, Chino XL. They're these guys that just like meta humans in terms of lyricism. This is what inspired them. This is what sparked their creativity. And it's just nuts, right? And again, album didn't sell well. But, you know, again, it's just the heads and it's a piece that people revisit for historical purposes and archival purposes. And that's what it is.
But I love, yeah. I just love the, like, the really aggressive rhyme schemes on here. Like, we're just getting rapid fire delivery. You know, I think that we've moved past them already in the review at this point, but this album has one of the great opening 3 songs. It just gets off to an amazing start. And there's other pockets on this album where you get that same level of technicality and intensity. I'm thinking Trilogy of Terror, you know, and this joint in particular as B-side joints of the album, side 2, where I'm getting that same electricity and that same energy, that same flow, that tempo, everything that I'm looking for, where it's not just having to appreciate it for like foundational or historical archival purposes. I'm just jamming out to the music.
Nah, I'm definitely you talk about the skin, the part like my brain is like a factory constantly creating material stitch by stitch for decoration. Lyrics are fabrics, beat is the lining. My passion and rhyming is fashion designing. Now it gets ordered because people want to sport it. You bought it. If you didn't, then you couldn't afford it. I mean, that's just.
And keep in mind, I know Kool G Rap best as a mafioso rapper. This is not the Kool G Rap that I grew up with. This is a Kool G Rap that I had to go back to and discover, right? So to me, the fact that like Dart was saying, like, I mean, I really do revere him as a storyteller. You know, Slick Rick for sure. Kool G Rap. You mentioned Ghostface, songs like Shaky Dog and Maxine. Amazing. I want to shout out Scarface because I think like The Diary, which I hope we get to at some point. Scarface, The Diary too, is definitely. So evocative. It's like a fucking movie on wax. Beautiful album. Amazing writer in general. But this is not the Kool G Rap that I'm most accustomed to or kind of how I picture him in my mind. And this shit still goes to me. So 8-, very comfortable with that rating. Could go up.
Yeah, I was looking forward to this too because I was telling Moulz, like, I've heard the name Kool G Rap my whole life, and I realized that I think getting him confused with Kool Moe Dee, who I was familiar with, and I was like, oh, these are not the same guy. Like, I don't think I've ever heard Kool G Rap, so it's like, all right, I get to fix this time, you know, because like I know a handful of Kool Moe Dee songs, and I'm like, those are two separate Kools.
You know, so. Oh yeah, Kool is back.
Yeah, you know, like I grew up like there's a what is it? It was like in the I guess late '80s, early '90s, and these were like passed down to me. So someone in my family must have had them, but like the NBA will put out these VHS tapes. Yeah. It's like NBA Superstars. And, yes. And they had like music videos. It's like it was the songs of the day to like highlight to basketball. And there was, I believe it was Kool Moe Dee was paired up with Akeem Olajuwon.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. And it was like, It was one of my favorite segments. Trying to remember the Kool Moe Dee song that they, that they paired up with.
Jesus Christ, please.
How You Like Me Now. Okay. How You Like Me Now.
All right.
And like, that stayed in my head, like, da-da-da-da-da. Like, it was in my head, like, my whole life. And so, like, you know, that, like, I go to work. So I was like, I knew I was a Kool Moe Dee fan, but I'm like, oh, this Kool G Rap, that's a different guy. I got to figure this out. So, you know.
Mel, in the sequence of this review, you've already heard it, but you know, this is a kind of album, just like Paid in Full, just like Long Live the Kane, where even if you haven't heard it, you've kind of already heard it. You've heard
because its words, DNA lyrics. Has been passed down
right.
Throughout.
I mean, we play that Go With the Flow by MF Doom, you know, Disciple by Nas on the title track. I mean, Trucks by J Dilla sampling the same Gary Numan record. So, you know, this is just, it's so embedded in everything that you do know and like, that you kind of already have heard it in a way.
Right. You know, it's
you
funny.
Just don't
I
know
mean,
it yet.
Right. It's funny. Like doing this, doing Biggie, Rakim, you know, it's, you hear these lines and moments. It's like, I've heard these countless times through other rappers.
Yeah.
Like, and that's influence.
Yes, absolutely. You know? Like, you know, Biggie came up with all these guys and was like studying them chapter and verse and putting his own spin on it. Because, you know, that's how you learn. You study greatness, and then you try to add on to it.
Right. You know, it's all. I mean, this show is definitely about just finding those threads too. You know, as much as it's about, you know, reviewing the music, it's we get to jump around history and make connections. And
jump around.
That's one of the. Yeah, jump around, you know, it's
we've
one of the
talked about them quite
the
a bit.
Show.
Mel had some trouble getting it straight about Everlast. And
oh, that's to tell on me.
Oh, I got the neck.
It was, I couldn't, I couldn't remember what was the issue? What was like?
You were confused as to like the who House of Pain were, and I was telling you they may, you know who they are. They may jump around. You
said, didn't I say it was like crisscross or something by accident? Like it was really
well crisscross. You were close. You know they made jump right.
Right. Yeah. It was just.
Yeah, the whole House of Pain crisscross story is one for the ages. Good Lord.
Really?
You know, we may just have to put House of Pain on the schedule at some point to hear the story.
Yes.
And bring you on for it.
And have me talk about how people thought they were from Boston forever, and me explaining that they weren't, and me getting into beef with people over writing pieces talking about Boston rap. You know, very few Boston rap groups broke out of the scene. You know, there's Edo G and the Bulldogs. There's House of Pain. And I'm like, oh, Jesus Christ. House of Pain were not from Boston. Are you sure?
Yeah, that's just like East Coast producer DJ Premier, right?
Oh, yeah. That's a fun one.
Oh, man. Hold on. This is news. Is he not from the East Coast?
He's from Texas.
Wow.
That's why, you know, when people were oh my God, I can't believe that Devin the Dude has Doobie Ashtray produced by DJ Premier. That's wild. Not really. He's
from the same Texas. Place. He's from the same place. Like you're aware that Devin the Dude, DJ Premier, and like UGK are all from the same state, right?
Yep. And once again, Bun B, he has a solo record with DJ Premier called Let Him Know. Another one that they were marveling at when it dropped. I can't believe it. Bun B working with Primo? What's going on? The internet's crazy.
Like you know how Static Selecta and Bun B met? Like, are you serious? Like, people are funny, man. I love Earth, man. I love Earth. I'm gonna try to stick around here for as long as I can. This shit is entertaining.
Word. Well, we hope you do. Yeah, this is your wealth of knowledge every time.
It's what I'm here for.
Yeah, Dart. It's always a pleasure to have you on, and we look forward to having you back on. Do you have anything new to plug other than I know you did some fact checking on that book?
So there's that book. There's a book that's coming out August 17th. Promise That You Will Sing About Me by Moulz Marshall Lewis. It's a book about Kendrick Lamar. That's coming out. I contributed to that book. I contributed to a book called A Little Devil in America in praise of black performance by Hanif Abdurraqib. I actually fact-checked that book and fact-checked that book. It's fucking amazing. Go find that. There's a book about hip hop producers that I actually wrote the foreword for that's coming out. I'm still waiting to hear about the exact date, but that's coming out. There's a book called Who's Got the Camera, made by Texas University Press, I believe, and I fact checked that and contributed to it, and that's going to be coming out October 5th. 2021, as is the same date that that's the book that Shea Serrano wrote recently, Hip Hop and Other Things, which I actually fact-checked and contributed to, which will be coming out again October 5th, 2021. That's going to be a great read. I believe that's going to be one of the biggest holiday sellers because, Jesus Christ, that book. I fact-checked it, and as I was fact-checking chapters, reading, trying to search about hip hop, I'm laughing my ass off.
That's great.
I will tell you
that our audience will love it. I think
I'll tell you, as somebody who knows hip hop and the minutia inside and out, there was nothing more fun than having Shea Serrano email me randomly. Hey, can you name as many songs you can where rappers made animal noises? And I'm like, what does this have to do? What does this have to do with any goddamn thing? And I'm like, okay, so Hyenas in the Desert made an album called Die Laughing, and they would laugh like hyenas during the track. On Redman would go, oh, ah, 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 you know, on Let the Monkey Out. Like, this is what I'm doing. And like, I'd send him like 20, and he's like, yo, thanks, good looking out. And I'm like, what is he going to do with this? And then he's like, hey, I just sent you a chapter to fact check. And when I read it, tears streaming down my face. I'm trying to fact check 4 or 5 pages that he wrote about rap. And so me, as somebody who's really into rap minutia and rap history and stuff like that, I've been in the publishing world for years. It made me an animal. And I've been going back and forth with literary agents trying to figure out, why won't they pick up this book? Why do I have to sell them on this idea? Don't they understand that people want this? And I talked to another guy, and he's like, are you aware that this book will probably sell 2,500 copies, and mostly it's going to sell to people like you and your friends? So it's going to be you and Amir and fucking DJ Khan and Alchemist and DJ Premier and DJ Quick and Just Blaze sitting in a corner giggling about this goddamn book, right? And I was like, oh, yeah, I get it. And you read Jay Serrano's books, and he sells to the masses. And like, I get it now. Rap's supposed to be fun. Music's enjoyable. It's supposed to be accessible to everybody. Not us talking about snares and kicks from obscure records that you can't find unless you go to Indonesia.
You know, that's what we found with the show, too. I think we started the show with just analysis in mind. And we didn't want to be like every other podcast where everyone's cracking jokes. And inevitably, we've turned into a podcast that's about 50% bullshitting and cracking jokes.
That's
and
what makes people listen. Straight analysis. That's what makes people listen. Yo, I grew up on Stretch and Bobbito, right? And what does Stretch and Bobbito do? We're going to play the most dirty, filthy, underground, unaccessible rap ever, and we're gonna crack jokes the whole damn show, so you laugh, and that's what makes you stay up till 3 a.m. You degenerate listening to rap. Rap you're not gonna hear anywhere else except for if you record it and you play it for your friends, because Stretch is not gonna play this goddamn song again, and you're gonna ask him 30 years later what it was, and he's not gonna know.
Oh, man.
I'm speaking from experience. Oh, God. I can only laugh.
I think Jada's got to take us out. Dart's here. Jada's got to take us out on this one.
Oh, absolutely. I think it's definitely in order. This has been another classic segment.
Dart Adams, like, you official.
I'll slap the shit out of anybody who says I ain't. No. All right.
There you go. That was a great moment.
Classic. It's fucking classic. Dart, thank you again, man. Just stick around for a sec. We got to grab your audio. And guys, we'll be right back with our final song review of the project. We got The Butcher Shop.
Yo, it's Mel from Rap Rankings. To hear the full episode this clip comes from and all the other episodes, stop by raprankings.com or search Rap Rankings on your favorite podcast platform.